So wildlife exemption, what it is, it's not really an exemption. It's a special use valuation. So that's kind of a misnomer. What it does is it doesn't make you exempt from paying taxes. It lowers your value on your land so that you're taxed on a lower rate or lower
tax rate. Bottom line.
Yeah, same rate, but bottom line.
Yeah.
And it's a really good deal. You got to be careful, though, because if you lose that, if you lose your ag or if you lose your wildlife, they can go back 5 years. And whether you were the owner or not, they can assess the difference in what you would have been paying under a regular tax rate versus what you get with the special valuation. So you got to be super careful on that. You file in the county where your land is situated. So this one's part Hayes and part Travis. We had to get permission from both. And we have to file our annual reports and everything in both counties. So whether I live in Travis, it doesn't matter. It's where the land's situated. And you have to have had a special use valuation, either ag or wildlife, the year before. So if you're just setting up wildlife, your land has to have been under ag before. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Then, this is the magic language. The land has to be used to propagate a sustaining, breeding, migrating, or wintering population of indigenous wild animals. And you have to propagate that for human use. So that can be if you're managing for whitetail and you're a hunter, that's a recreational use and that counts. If you're a bird watcher, if you want to do it for hiking, if you want to do photography, wildlife photography, those are all legitimate uses. And what's the other one? Passive enjoyment. You have to have 95% of the land under wildlife management, and so your houses, your barns, tool sheds, that doesn't count. So, but 95% of the land has to be under wildlife management. And I think that it is a minimum of 20 acres for a single property. If you're in a management co-op, it's 12 and a half unless you found out something different.
If it's already ag exempt, it can be lower as long as it was ag exempt the year before.
Okay.
So as long as nothing changed on your parcel, and you were assessed previously at ag exempt, then you can qualify for wildlife.
Okay. And it doesn't matter if it's 12 and a half acres?
It does not. It can be as small as 5 acres. Ooh. And it can be, I don't know what the minimum is, but I know I was asking and inquiring and I was okayed and approved with the 5 acres.
I ran across the 12 and a half and I thought, I think right. I know something differently.
Yeah. And then Constance.
Is how much?
Ours is an 11 and a half. We are filing for ag exemption. We're told to be on it for 5 years and then we qualify for the wildlife.
And that's what I was going to say with Constance was 7. She's been working to get her wildlife with bees. So for the last 5 years, and this will be her 5th year, she's had to manage bees.
That's me too.
And then on her 5th year, then she will get her wildlife exemption.
Yeah. Her wildlife or her ag?
Your
ag exemption after 5 years, and then your 6th year you can apply for the wildlife.
Right,
and it's 5 years wait
and
for the
ag. And it's called 1D1 open space.
Yes. And if it has a W over there, it's a wildlife open space.
Wow.
Once you do get approved, you've got to file an annual report, both counties. And you're going to have periodic inspections. Hayes County is, I love the lady that comes out.
Melissa.
She comes out for that long, you know, but she sees everything. And she does hands-on inspections. Travis County goes, send me your paperwork and we're fine. And what was the other thing? Periodic inspections, annual report. You've done your 5-year plan. And here's what you've got to do. So there's 7 activity areas. And you've got to do 3 of the 7 in order to qualify. There's habitat control, erosion control, predator control, supplemental water, supplemental food, say it again?
Did I say watershed protection?
Erosion control, it falls under there. Or that can also fall under habitat. Habitat's this really big umbrella.
And census.
Yeah, and census. So let's take a deeper dive on that. Habitat control, like I said, is a big umbrella. It's got a lot of different things. What we do for our habitat control is brush management. When we bought this property, it was already pretty much the ash juniper was cleared. Prior to that, because we're right next door, you know, we bought the stuff next door, it was a cedar thicket so thick you couldn't even walk through it. It was ridiculously thick. I think they probably over-cleared, but it's better than it was, I think. Each year we've got 10% of the land or 10 acres, and we hand trim little junipers. And where we're going to go, you're going to see on one side it's done, and then on the other side it's not one of the 10 acres that we've gotten to yet. So you can tell a difference, but it's not massive. We also plant stuff, so we've put in chinkapin oaks and lacy oaks and a few bur oaks. Just as we go, those are long projects though, because hand watering out here when you got to take the bucket is kind of a fun job. So we plant those. You can also, all this is all in habitat, the habitat umbrella, grazing management. Like Frank was talking about, fencing off an area so the cattle aren't getting to it, or not having your livestock on an area, just basic grazing management counts. Establishing a prairie counts. So I think that one's, how much do you have to do? Range enhancement is 10% or 10 acres. You can do prescribed burning. If you do prescribed burning, you have to have a plan. With prescribed burning, things don't go according to plan. So you have to have a plan B. You can do riparian improvement. And that's under habitat control. It's also under erosion control. So keeping vegetation along your creek beds, planting things along your creek beds, fencing it off from livestock, things like that. And that'll buy you 10 years of your five-year plan. So you can do that. You can do wetland improvements. You can do looking for a specific bird. There's a But each specific thing has a whole litany that I'm not going to go through. So if you want to do a golden shriek warbler, there's a whole plan for what you have to do there. You can do management for, I'm cheating.
Just pick songbirds. So you want?
I mean, you can put up bluebird houses.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's going to be under one of the other.
The other ones, that's in that habitat.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So erosion control follows under there. We don't really do that. We keep the vegetation along our stream beds, but we don't do a lot. And we've done some terracing, but not a lot here. We do predator control. And so that's the third. There's habitat control, erosion control, predator control. That doesn't stand alone. You got to have it relate to whatever wildlife critter that you're protecting, right? So we do songbirds, and we do small mammals, and we do turkeys. And our predator control is for fire ants. You have to do smaller, lesser of. Sometimes it's the greater of. That one's the greater of 10% or 10 acres. And we use what's called Extinguish Plus. If you're going to be grazing animals that are going to be eaten, you just use Extinguish. Works pretty well. What we don't do, so we love our... I'm a horned lizard, and I'm involved in that horned lizard project, which I think some of you are going to help me on if we ever get invited back. And we like our harvest ant mans, and we keep them separate, and we don't put any we don't treat the fire ants within 50 yards of those. But you'll see some on the way out. They're blocked off. Not enough. Cowbirds. Everybody love cowbirds? That's a predator. And you have to take 30 annually to qualify. You also, there's another separate category for grackles and starlings and house sparrows. Are they all together?
They are
all together. Mm-hmm. And again, 30 annually. So those are predators. You can also do...
How do you document that? Do you just write you've killed 30, or do you have to take pictures?
I take pictures. I don't kill them. I'm not a hunter kind of person.
Yeah, I can't kill them. That's my problem.
But I do take pictures of stuff, and you know, like we had a guy that he was doing feral hogs out here, and he would take pictures and he would weigh them on all that. But I don't know that I think that
no,
may be
I mean
overkill.
Just, you have to have photo documentation that you did 30.
That's what I did.
You do have to document, and it's all about documenting the activity, not necessarily the results.
Okay.
So if you try to put a pig trap out and you try to capture the feral hogs, but you never get one, just the fact that you participated in the activity, you document it, you baited it, and it's not based on the results.
But if you have a threshold of 30.
So then why did they give you a threshold 30?
I don't know. I think the idea with management is, and Melissa has said this, it's, are you making a good faith effort? Are you making a good faith effort? I can't get those words out.
Good faith effort.
You can do it, raccoons. I've got a friend that he pays his neighbor's kids like $5 a tail for raccoons.
Which eat little horny toads.
They do.
And that's terrible.
Feral hogs, what can I get you for? So that's three. We've got habitat control, erosion control, predator control. Number four is supplemental water. This one's easy. Super easy. We've got a well, put up a stock tank. It's on a float, so it replenishes constantly. We clean it out periodically. And it gets you 10 years on your wildlife, which is great. You can do plateau management has a, I think it's plateau, has, I think it's called a guzzler. And it's a rainwater collection. If you don't have access to a well, it's a rainwater collection water feature, water trough for the wildlife. It's pretty cool. That buys you 10 years. You can establish a wetland or a marsh. Maybe not here because we don't have that much rain. But you got to get Texas Parks and Wildlife involved in that. And if you've got a spring, take care of your spring. And that'll buy you 10 years. Number five is providing supplemental food. You can do planting. If you do 1% of your land, plant it in whatever your, some seasonal forage. Or what we do is we've got a standalone, it's a free feed turkey feeder. You're going to see it. It's down here. It looks like a big green tub up on a platform with holes cut in it. And I think that qualifies, you've got to have one free form, free feeding feeder for 320 acres. So that's a pretty good deal. It's got to be 16% protein. For our turkey feeder, we do 75% scratch grains and then 25% black oil sunflower seed. And it needs to be filled, so don't look in it. But that's there. And part of this is that you have to keep up on it. And I do. I really do. I just didn't write last week. So number six is providing shelter. There's our nest boxes. We've got about 24 nesting boxes around here because we do songbirds. When we bought the land, they were already up, and they gave us these GPS coordinates. Well, that's great, except you gotta find them, and that's hard. So what we've done is as you're looking around, you're gonna see orange blazes with a number on it, and that's how it's a lot easier to find them if you have the tree blazed. Go up. You've got to clean them a couple of times a year. You tap it, and that's going to, if it starts buzzing, you know that there's red wasps in there. If a snake pokes its head out, you go, oh, hello. Sometimes what's in there doesn't move. I opened one. It was in a titmouse house, and it had a little mouse in it. It's wrong kind of mouse, but it was cute. And that's always kind of fun to do. I really enjoy seeing what's built a nest. And there was one year, and I had cleaned them, I'd cleaned them earlier, but there were three different stratifications of nests in there, which was, that was pretty cool.
I imagine you can do bats and bat houses and owl houses too.
Yes. If you've got an owl house, for the most part, you want them facing northeast. If you've got an owl house, you want it facing to the south. I had a little owl fly out at me.
I had a speaked owl this year.
Yeah, because they're fun. So, also in habitat, you've seen brush piles around. That cedar that we clear goes on a brush pile, and that counts. I mean, we don't count it because we've got the nesting boxes, but it does count. Snags and crevices and holes. That one they have I don't know how you keep track of this. Snags, it's 5 snags per acre on 5% of the land. Brush piles, it's 1% of the land.
One brush pile.
Depends on how big that brush pile is.
Yeah.
And I didn't even know about this. There's a thing called half-cutting trees. So when I was doing this research, you can half-cut your tree, and then it falls on the side, so it makes a sort of a tent, and that creates great habitat for your critters. And for that one, you got to have, what is it? 1 clump of trees per 100 yards on at least 10 acres, or 10%.
Too much math.
It's a lot of math.
Is that what the county folks come out and inspect? Is the rough percentages?
I don't think they've ever inspected our percentages.
Okay.
When she's come out, I'll say, look, there's a birdhouse. There's a birdhouse. Here's a slash pile. This is our water feature. And you've got 15 minutes mm-hmm. with her. And so you drive really quick. And she's not calculating. I think she's seeing, okay. Are you doing it right? Yeah. That's good faith effort.
Yep.
Yeah. Or are you one of those people
that... Did you match your report?
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, so the last one is census counts. And that's just to keep an eye on what's happening around here. That's not one of the things that we do, but I've got neighbors that manage for the whitetail, and so we go out on a spotlight count. And you have to do 3 per year, and it has to be 5 miles each, basically, so 15 miles total. And you go out at night, it's really fun. You spotlight and you count. You got to say what the weather is, what the cloud cover is, so the temperature. And then you count how many bucks, does, and fawns. That's really great in theory. So what happens is we're usually doing it in August or September. The grass is high. You can't see anything but these little ears coming up. So you can also do daytime counts. In daytime counts, you look at, I think it's 2 hours a day, morning or evening, and you have to do it 3 times a year. And on those, you've got that 5 mile per trip deal, unless you've got a small tract of land. If you've got a small tract of land, you can do 2 hours a day, 5 times, and do it from your deer blind. Easy peasy. You can also do aerial counts for those of you who have your own little helicopters that
drone.
Yeah. Oh!
A drone?
I guess you could do a drone.
Sure. Not that we advocate drones, but...
What I was doing my research on was written long before drones, and back when 12 and a half acres was the norm. You can do spring or winter bird counts. I haven't done that, but I'd like to. And that's it on the census. Document, 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 because you got to file that annual report. And what I found, and I love doing it this way because I did it the hard way before, everybody's got their phone with them all the time. Mm-hmm. You go to the feed store, you take a picture of that receipt, you email it to yourself. You fill the turkey feeder, take a selfie with your feed that you're doing it. It's got your date, it's got the weather, it's got everything you need, and then I think it's in most email formats, but in Gmail you can do a subfolder. So I have one that says wildlife, and then it's divided up by year. End of the year, I've got it all there.
Click and
really
send.
Easy. Click and send. But document, document, document. And I do pictures because it's usually with a phone.
Yeah.
And because otherwise I have to write myself an email, and I'm not good at
that.
So
the annual reports, do they give you a template that you have to fill out, or do you have to freehand it?
They give you a template. I kind of freehand mine now.
Yeah.
I started out using Plateau Land Management because they were the ones that had had this property before. And that was a really good way to sort of get my feet on the ground and figure out what I had to do.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was providing them all the stuff for the annual report, and I thought, why am I not just putting this together anyway? So, it was better that way, but they're good. But most of you guys are treating your land like this anyway. And so it's not that difficult. It's the documentation and getting it approved, getting through that 5-year period. Yeah. No more.